Good morning, everyone. We want to welcome you once again to our LCF live stream. Thanks for being with us. We are so glad that we have the ability to do this. And wherever you are, wherever you're watching, whoever you're with, we want to just encourage you right now that we are going to enter into the presence of the Lord together. And we are so excited to do this. And we're so thankful that we have the ability to do this morning. And so I even want to, as we worship this morning, I want to even encourage you to stand wherever you are. I want to encourage you, if you are with your family, to clap. I want to encourage you to actually get up and to actually engage in worship. And in that way, to actually engage with us. And so that can just be helpful, actually, in moving us into a posture of worship. I want to also read something for us before we move into worship. And it's Psalm 63. And really, I was struck by this. And I'm sure many of you, as we're reading scripture in these days, there's so much in the midst of what we're going through that just feels so relevant. But David says, "O God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, my flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where there is no water." Does it feel sometimes like right now we are in a dry and weary land where there is just so much that we do not have? And so then David says, "So I have looked upon you in the sanctuary, beholding your power and glory." And you know, we can't come into the church together, and as much as we would love to do that, we know that physically right now that's not possible, but we can enter into the sanctuary, into the presence of God. Wherever we are, as we worship together, we can actually step into that. And we behold the power and glory of God. And then he says, "Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you. So I will bless you as long as I live. In your name, I will lift up my hands." And then a few verses later, David says, "My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me." When I read that, I thought that my soul needs to cling to the Lord in these days. And I feel that need. I need to be in the presence of the Lord. And so I want to invite you, as we enter into worship together, as we engage, have cling to the Lord this morning. Raise your hands. Bless him. Behold the power and the glory of God. He's amazing, and he's moving, and he's working through us in these days. And so let's worship together. We're going to have a little bit of a different format this morning, part of just because we're doing things differently, and so we don't have to follow maybe the way that we would do things live on a Sunday morning. So we're going to have some songs here at the beginning, and then we'll transition, and then we'll come back to worship later. So hope that's a blessing to you. And once again, wherever you are, let's join in together, and let's worship the Lord.
Amen. Well, it's always good to praise and worship Jesus together. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to start off, and we're going to sing "Build Your Kingdom." And as I was picking songs this week, I thought, this is so great, because the chorus says, "Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win the nations back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray." And Lord, that's what we want. We want to be set on fire for you right now. We need our streets and our lands to be healed, Lord Jesus. And we want your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven, and to build it here. So amen. So let's praise. Amen. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we were made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. Refuse to waste
joy and prize to see the captives' hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We
to praise Jesus. All right, I just want to read to a scripture, and I feel it goes well with everything, you know. Yeah, like Paul was saying, the words that I'm reading in my Bible these days are just being like they're so alive, right? And we need that scripture. We need that truth pouring into our lives and our hearts so that our hearts and our minds are focused on Jesus. And this is one that's just been always amazing for me, and I'm sure for many of you. It's Lamentations 3, 21 to 24. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. And Jesus, we thank you for those words. And we put our hope and our trust in you. and you are so faithful, Jesus.
Something as we were worshiping there, and I was brought to mind that yes, we are holding on to the Lord, and we make a decision that yes, in the midst of these storms, we are holding on to the Lord, but I'm also reminded that it's the Lord who's holding on to us. In Matthew 14, Jesus walks on the water and he comes to the disciples in the middle of the storm. And he says to them, in the middle of the storm, in the midst of everything that's raging around them, and there's all sorts of things raging around us right now, and he says, take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. And it says, Peter answered him, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. And he said, come. And so Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. And how many of us right now are feeling like in the midst, there's these things coming at us. We're alert. We are beginning to be afraid. And we're like, Lord, save us. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took a hold of him, saying to him, O you of little faith, why did you doubt? And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him. Jesus is holding on to us.
Yes, amen, amen.
Quietness.
Jesus, we so desperately need you in these days. We do not know many times what to do, where to turn, how to react. Lord, there's so many things right now coming at us daily that make us go, what is going on? But God, you know. Jesus, you are enthroned above all things, and you know. And you love us, and you're with us, and you are moving and working through us and through your church in these days, and you are bringing about such good. And know the storms and the seas wage around us, and rage and all sorts of things are happening. Lord, you are in control. Want to welcome you once again, and we're so glad that you've joined us and that you are watching this and gathering together and joining together with us. We are so grateful. Just a few things that we want to mention here as we are together. Obviously, there's not a lot of things really at all happening in the church building, and so obviously we're restricted physically. But we're looking to how we can do things together during these days. And so one of the things that we're going to be doing this week, we mentioned it in our church email last week, we're going to be doing prayer Tuesday mornings at 6:30 a.m. and Wednesdays at 9 p.m. In our weekly update, we had mentioned that we were going to do it on Google Hangouts, but actually we're going to move it. We're going to do it on a platform called Zoom. It's just easier if we streamline it and do it on Zoom. So just watch your church email. There's going to be one either today or tomorrow that's going to come and give you the links for those of you that want to join us. But we would really encourage you. We feel that prayer right now during this time is so crucial, that we are joining together weekly in prayer, asking the Lord to move, and there's so many things that we need to look to Him for. And so we would love if a bunch of us would join together in prayer during these days. So that's Tuesday 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 a.m. and then also Wednesday 9 to 10 p.m. and we'll send out those links. We also just want to make mention of giving during this time. We really appreciate your financial support and generosity to the church in these days, and we're all sensitive to the impact that these changes are having on us. For those of you with jobs and livelihoods that are being significantly impacted, we're praying that God will not only guide you through this time, but also He is going to provide for you. And so if you are being impacted financially, we would even please let us know so that we can pray specifically for you. We'd love to be lifting that up to the Lord. Our encouragement is that we would continue to be faithful in these days to with what God has entrusted to us. And so for those that are earning as before, let's continue to be faithful to the Lord with our tithes in these days. It's important for the church. And for those impacted financially during this season, let's be faithful in what we have. And in doing so, let's entrust our finances to the Lord. Let's trust the Lord to provide for us. As far as giving goes, you can go to lcflandmark.com/give. That's where you'll find information on giving. You can also e-transfer funds to givetolcf@gmail.com. There's no password needed. You can also get in touch with the church office if you'd prefer to drop off tithe. Email us at office@lcflandmark.com. I want to provide us some time here. There's actually a call today to a national day of prayer for the church. And so we want to invite you right now. We're gonna pause here for a couple minutes, and I want to invite you wherever you are to pray specifically for the stop of the spread of this virus in Canada. And we want to pray that God would be moving through His church and moving through His people in these days. And so as we're doing that, we're joining with churches all around this country who are putting this before the Lord. And so let's take 2 minutes. Let's do that. Let's pray together wherever you are, and then we'll come back and we're going to dig into the word together. So let's meet back here in 2 minutes. All right, we are back. I hope that you enjoyed that opportunity there to pray for the country and what's going on in our nation. Also, I want to make a quick mention too. I want to encourage you to give us a follow in these days on Instagram, Facebook, and on YouTube. These are our days where we're really trying to stay connected via social media and online. And so find us on those platforms, and we post things there that are helpful for the church. And we've also got some exciting things that we're working on, different ways to communicate and to be able to share the word with you. So keep an eye out for that in the coming days. So last Sunday, we talked about the five reasons why we don't need to worry. Why I don't need to worry, why you don't need to worry. And this Sunday is sort of part two of that, if you will. We know that we don't need to worry. We know what the word says to us about not worrying. But then the question becomes, how do I trust Jesus to meet my needs? And so that's where we're going to go this morning. And you can probably, I'm sure all of us can identify when I say that these past 2 weeks kind of feel like a bit of a shock. Like I still feel right now even that I'm still somewhat in a bit of shock of what's happening, of what's transpired. And it just has happened so quickly that our lives have just been so significantly altered. And God is not just allowing this situation to reveal our hearts and to speak into our lives. There is tremendous good that's going to come out of this crisis in the church and in us as people. And so, where is God? This is the question that I'm asking myself, and I want to put to us. Where is God seeking to bring more of his presence in your life? How is the Holy Spirit desiring to heal and refine you in these days? What does he want to do in you in the very midst of what we're going through? Where do you feel, and I feel this very acutely right now, but where do we feel pressured and squeezed by the Lord? Like there's things bearing on us, and we can't deny that the Lord is allowing this to happen, that God has allowed this to come. And so, God, what are you wanting to say to me now? What are you wanting to do in us? And amidst the slowdown of this busyness in our lives, and I have never seen more people walking than I have lately. And so amidst this sort of self-isolation that we're experiencing, please, I would say this is not a time to be idle in the Lord. This is not a time to press pause or to in any way pull back from the Lord. This is actually an opportunity to go deep with the Father. This to dig deep wells of fellowship with God in our lives. And so I'm asking myself that right now is where am I right now prone to distractions that are going to leave me spiritually depleted? Where do I need to really look at my life of where I need to go deep with the Father? And so the world is in crisis right now, right? I think we'd agree. The world is in a full-blown crisis. I don't know that we could point to anything else that you could even say compares to this because of the age that we find that we're living in. And I also believe that what this is doing is it's exposing a crisis that's been there for a long time in the church. It's actually been in the church, but we've just kind of been able to ignore it. Will we seek to understand and see what the Lord is doing in his church? Jesus is always seeking to work through his church. He's always seeking to move through his church. And so the fact that God's allowed this to happen, what does the Lord specifically want to do in these days to move in the church? And God is redeeming this situation for his holy purposes in our lives and in the church. I actually believe that this is going to be a time where he is seeking to refine and solidify his work in us and in the church. God is seeking a generation of worshipers who will not be satisfied with anything else except the actual working of his presence in our midst. There is nothing else. God wants to raise up a generation of people. We are not satisfied with anything but the presence of God himself. And I find this so interesting, what he's doing right now in our midst to get our attention. Now, God didn't bring this virus about. I am 100% sure of that God didn't bring this virus about. And the reason I say that is because every time Jesus encounters sickness and death in the Gospels, every single time he sees it not as the work of his Father, he sees it as the work of the enemy. And he sees it actually as an opportunity to bring the goodness and the love and the healing of the Father into the situation. Jesus brings wholeness and healing where the enemy is trying and attempting to bring sickness and death. And that is exactly what the enemy is trying to do all over the world right now, is just bring loads and loads of suffering and death. But God is allowing the coronavirus for his own purposes of good on this earth. Nothing happens, nothing, anything happens except that which God permits. And so what a virus like this does is expose where our treasure, where our security, where our comfort resides. And what Jesus is allowing is he's allowing these facades of comfort that we've built up around us to be torn away, so that actually what's being revealed is what's really holding our hearts. And I don't know about you, but that's hard. As Jesus is stripping away this stuff and I'm having to see the stuff that's really making me uncomfortable and really is leaving me unsettled. And Jesus is, he's getting at the issues in our hearts. And what we need is a robust view of the kingdom of God. And what I mean by that is in these days, we need that view of really understanding. We are not made to live on this earth forever in its present format. We are made for heaven. We are made for the new heavens and the new earth. But in view of eternity, whether I live on this earth for 40 years or 80 years is actually really inconsequential in light of eternity. It actually is not the biggest thing. Now, I understand that actually might offend some of us when you go, well, what do you mean? I want to live way beyond 40. Yes, so do I. But in view of eternity, that is not the biggest thing on this earth for me. I understand that offends us, because what it does is it reveals where we're solely living for the things of this earth. I am in Christ, which means if I am in Christ, I am secure. But if I'm living for the things of this earth, then this time will be very unsettling. If I'm simply living for the things of this earth, this is shaking everything. But it's also the mercy of God where he's saying, turn, repent, seek my face, humble yourselves. And, you know, as a professing Christian, it's good for us actually to feel unsettled to the point where we ask ourselves the really big questions like, what am I living for? What am I really living for? Now, I'm beginning here today as we talk about trusting Jesus, because the only way that you will overcome the inclination to worry, to fear, and anxiety in your life, and all of that feels really, really relevant right now. I don't know that there's been a time in our lives that we would say worry, fear, and anxiety has felt more real and relevant than right now. The only way that we will overcome that is to trust Jesus and to live for him. That's the only way. You will not overcome it unless you can find somehow to put your trust in the Lord. And sadly, it'll actually be entirely possible for some people to come out of this crisis through being careful, through being wise, and actually not be any closer to God. Not to be any closer to the Lord of heaven and earth who formed them and who longs to have relationship with them. They will come out and life will just continue until we come to the next crisis on this earth. And this is not going to be the last crisis that this earth faces. This may not even be the last crisis that we face in our lifetime. This may just be the beginning of more unsettling things as the presence of Jesus and the kingdom of God is moving into this earth. That in itself is a bit unsettling. I feel that's unsettling. But we need to rest in the Lord and in the truth of his word. Amidst all the death and destruction that Satan seeks to bring through this crisis, his main plan is to leave people eternally separated from God and the church in a state of spiritual slumber. That's what he wants to do. And so what we need to know and what we need to constantly remind ourselves and live out of this, actually walk in this, is Jesus is on the throne. Jesus is above all things. All things are under his power and dominion. There's nothing that isn't under him. We are actually raised up with him. We are called to be seated with him right now in the heavenlies, in eternal places. He is preparing his church for his return. We are called to be working and preparing for that. We are called to be living for his kingdom, moving in the power of his spirit. That is what we need to remind ourselves of and live ourselves, that we are living right now. Regardless of what's happening, we're living for the kingdom of God and we're moving in the power of his spirit, come what may. And we can speak of awakening and renewal in the church. Big picture, right? We can talk about that. But what are you doing right now in your life to create hunger and desire for more of God? Personally, what are you doing? How is your prayer life? How is your secret life with God? God has given us the way to deal with worry in our lives. In the midst of this crisis, in the midst of the unknown, we actually don't have to live in a state of worry. And I am so thankful for that, because there's so many things that want me to have give way to worry in my life. But the way that we reject that is we put our trust in Jesus. And when I talk about putting our trust in Jesus, I'm not talking about a one-time decision like I came to Christ and I put my trust in Jesus. No, this is an intentional act again and again and again, daily, maybe even hourly at times. I am going to place my trust in Jesus. No matter what, I know that he is working in all things. So, how do I trust Jesus to meet my needs? I want to go through 4 points this morning. Number one, every day, ask him to be my shepherd. Last Sunday, I touched on Psalm 23:1, where it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," which also means I don't have to lack. I shall not lack. There's nothing that I will lack. Nothing. And the next verse, which many of us probably know, is, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." And the Hebrew there for still waters, interestingly, is translated "besides waters of rest." The Lord will bring us, he'll actually bring us to time and places in our lives where he invites us to receive him as our shepherd, to feed, to lead, and to meet my needs. And this reminds us, as the Lord does this reminds us, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is a good God. He is good. And I said this last week, but we need a huge, massive view right now, a huge understanding of the goodness of God. Like, that God is infinitely good. That what we're going through right now doesn't in any way put into question his goodness. He's infinitely good. And he's for our good. And he's working for our good right now. At the beginning of 2020, the beginning of this year, we entered into a time of prayer and fasting, and I did this little mini 3-part series, if you remember, about eliminating hurry in our lives, engaging in silence and solitude, and rediscovering Sabbath in our lives. And it hit me this week. I was thinking about that, and I actually went back and I looked through some of my notes. And I was like, we had no idea what was around the corner, like zero. I had no clue when I was preparing that and preaching that of what we were going to be in 2.5 months later. And it's like, we talk about this stuff, but God has literally just pulled the emergency brake of busyness in our lives. Like, he has just yanked that brake up, and it's like, it has been a full-scale stop. Like, stop. And I know that for some of us it might feel like the opposite, and I can actually attest to this. I don't feel right now less busy. I feel like I've walked through actually some of the most busy weeks right now in a long time. But we are still in a time right now where the Lord has made us to lie down beside still waters. He has brought us to a place of rest. And whether we like it or not, we are being told, you need to rest. And one effect in all of this is that this has made us realize, all of us, how little control we have. Like, we really do not have control. And how quickly our lives can be turned upside down. And for followers of Jesus, this is meant to draw us to realize the Lord is my shepherd. He is the one who takes care of me. He is the one who guides me. He's the one who makes me lie down. He's the one, not me. He's the one. But we still have the choice right now, in the midst of all this, of looking to our own resources, our own devices, and I'm intending that pun. But we have that choice to look to things in within us or outside of us to make it through. And it would be tragic if in the midst of this, that's where we go. It would be tragic if we just get bogged down in weeks and weeks and weeks and months of distraction and we don't actually meet the Lord. It's tragic. The Lord is saying, church, wake up. Don't slumber. Don't go into your devices for the next number of weeks and just lose yourself in endless numbers of shows. Don't do that. Rather, every day we trust Jesus to meet our needs by declaring, you are my shepherd. You're good. You protect me. You guide me. Now, this doesn't mean that we're not to heed governmental authority in these days. We do. We are doing that, and we should do that. But we don't give ourselves to worry in the midst of this. God has this under control. Do you believe that? That God actually has all of this. Every single thing is under his control. John 10, 14 and 15. Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. We can trust Jesus in these days because he tells us plainly, I'm the good shepherd. The promise of God woven throughout Scripture to take his sheep and to lead them and to guide them and to care for them. Jesus says, I'm it. This is me. I'm the good shepherd. Like, isn't that encouraging? Like, you read that and it's just, he tells us so plainly there in the Gospels. That's me. Like, he's not speaking in riddles. He's like, this is me. That's who I am. And did we catch what Jesus said there? Do we actually believe this? He says, the relationship that I and the Father have can actually be had between you and me. That we can have the relationship with Jesus of him and the Father. Just think about that for a second. The relationship that the God of heaven and earth, the Father, has with his Son Jesus in the Godhead, that level of relationship, he says, you can have with me. That's mind-blowing. Every day, you can pray Psalm 28:9. Over yourself, over your family, over others, where it says, oh, save your people and bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forever. We can pray, Jesus, be my shepherd. Jesus, carry me. I need you in these days to carry me. All right. How do I trust Jesus to meet my needs? Number two, give him first place in every area of my life. I mentioned this last week, but you know, we can live with this kind of very unbalanced perspective in our lives. Like, I'm trusting God for my eternal salvation. That's the biggest need that I have. Like, no comparison. I need someone to save me. I'm trusting that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that he has my heart and my soul for all eternity. Okay, that he has my life. And then I'm not sure that I can trust him for that mortgage payment or that car payment or whatever payment. I can't trust him that he'll take care of my family. Like, really? We can live as though we need to take care of certain areas ourselves. And I'm not disputing responsibility. We need to walk with responsibility in our lives. But Jesus invites us to give him every area of our lives. Every messy closet, every messy drawer. How many of you have a messy closet or a messy drawer? All that stuff. What do we actually think it means to invite Jesus into our lives? It's inviting him to have everything. Matthew 6, this is what we were looking at last week. I'm going to come back to it. Matthew 6, verses 31 to 33, and I'm reading this again out of the Living Bible. Jesus says, so don't worry at all about having enough food and clothing. Why be like the heathen? For they take pride in all these things and are deeply concerned about them. But your heavenly Father already knows perfectly well that you need them, and he will give them to you if you give him first place in your life and live as he wants you to. Now, really simple interpretation for us here. God knows all your needs. He knows every single one of your needs. He even knows the needs that you yourself don't see. He sees them. So there's some phrases that you'll never hear God say. And maybe you've heard this before, but you'll never hear God say, oops, or, well, I didn't know that, or, didn't see that one coming. Like, oh man, how did that ever happen? Jesus, how did we let that happen? You'll never, ever, that doesn't happen. God will actually allow needs in your life so that you'll actually come to Him. He'll actually allow you to have big needs in your life so that you'll realize, I am not meant to try and be self-sufficient on my own. I'm not meant to try and walk through this life and find all the sufficiency in myself. No, I'm meant to come to the Father. Worry is a warning system, if you will. It's a big warning system. It reveals an area, actually, where I have not made God number one. Anytime I worry, it's showing me I have not put God on the throne in that. Wherever we have something not under the lordship of Jesus, or any area that we haven't given first place to Jesus, any area like that will be a source of insecurity and worry for all of our life if we don't give it to Him. Meaning, those who haven't submitted their lives to Jesus, they will worry about everything. People will worry about everything if they have not yielded to Jesus. The cure is, come to the Lord. And even, the thing is, we find that, like, even as professing Christians, we can have these kind of mixed up value systems that we're operating out of. Like we're sort of half submitted to the Lord, kind of, but then in this area we really know we're not, and we're mixed up. When we give it to Jesus, it simplifies priorities, and there's a whole lot less to worry about. Now, there right now, there is so much that we can worry about. Like scads and scads and scads of stuff. So many theories about this virus and what to do and what not to do and where it came from and how this is happening and where this is all going to end up. Can I really encourage you, set your face on Jesus. He holds our lives. He actually holds your life. Nothing else. And if the Father calls any of us home in this, it's gain. It's actually gain. I know we struggle to believe that. The Word says it's gain. To live is Christ. To die is gain. I'm reminding myself, Paul, you need an eternal perspective. You need to get your eyes off of the temporal and get your eyes on to the eternal. Because when we make something, Lord, that shouldn't be, our job, marriage, children, health, bank accounts, it creates stress, it creates worry, it creates insecurity. These are good things, but they do not deserve God's place. And one of the things we worry about most, and perhaps probably even more right now, is we worry about money. We worry about getting it. We worry about keeping it. We worry about saving it. We worry about spending it, investing it, protecting it. We worry and worry and worry about money. And we're told, give it to God. The point is, in all of this, is that what God gives to me, He wants to give through me. He actually desires to use you to meet the needs of others. And so, how do we do that? How do we actually see that everything that God is giving us, everything is actually meant to flow through me to help others? All right, how do I trust Jesus to meet my needs? Number three, relax and give Him my worries in prayer. So when you feel worry, fear, anxiety coming on, make a list of all the things that God has done for you, all the things He's given you, all the blessings that He's poured into your life. All of it. Make a list, because all that He's given you, nothing is by chance. Nothing. Not one single thing. And sometimes we also actually need to make a list of our worries. Like, make a list. What is bugging me? Write it down. Just Don't do it on social media. Give it to the Lord. Don't give it to others. Put it before Him and not before others. But write down your worries. And as you write down your worries, God, this is what I'm worrying about, then release it to the Lord. Jesus, you have it. I've given it to you. And please hear me in this. Pushing down worry doesn't work. When worried, don't suppress, don't repress. Rather, express it and confess it to God. Don't bury it. So suppressing worry, actually, it's like taking a can of Coke and shaking it and then sticking it in the freezer or sticking it in the trunk of your car, which some of us have done. Do you know what happens when that can of Coke goes into the freezer and freezes? It explodes everywhere. My car trunk has, well, my older car still has remnants of that. But it explodes, and that's what worry does. It explodes into our work. It explodes into relationships. It explodes into our marriage. It explodes into parenting. It just explodes into areas in our lives. Matthew 6:32. It speaks of all these things that we can run after. And the Greek there implies this intense pursuit, like running after in an intense way, that we're consumed by this, that there's this thing that we, this process, this possessing, and this we want to demand this, that we're running after these things, that we must have them. The stuff that consumes the lives of people, always needing more, always keeping up with the Joneses. By the way, why did the Joneses get such a bad rap? Like, what was it about the Joneses specifically? Like, why wasn't it like the Friesens or someone else that people wanted to keep up with? Why was it the Joneses? Anyways, I always wondered about that. But it's running after all these things that we don't need to. It's about living in the security of Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. Living with this peace that surpasses understanding. It won't actually make sense to people. They'll look at you and they'll go, that doesn't make sense. Living with a non-anxious presence in your life that will actually bring glory to Jesus. I'm thinking a lot about this. I am needing to continually grow in this. But this thing of, and especially in a time like this, how can I live with a non-anxious presence? Like that when I'm dealing with people, when I'm coming into contact with situations, how can I exude this peace that surpasses all understanding? That's guarding my heart and guarding my mind. Because that is a witness to a world that is amidst chaos. They look at that and they go, that doesn't make sense. And I believe that there's enough people that are walking in that as followers of Jesus. They will make a profound difference with people. This promise of peace that comes from the releasing of worry and anxiety in prayer and intercession, it says there. Not through social media, not through conversations with others. That's not actually how we release our anxiety. We release our anxiety in prayer and intercession. How do I trust Jesus to meet my needs? The fourth one. Trust Him for one day at a time. We get 24-hour increments for a reason. Matthew 6:34, the very next verse after the section that we've been in. And this is the application of it for our lives, if you will. This is after everything that Jesus has said, this is sort of the application of it. So he says, so don't be anxious about tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow too. Live one day at a time. In the Message, it says, don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. I'm following the news every day there's like this constant, like ongoing stream of updates. And you don't know, like, what is tomorrow going to bring? I don't know. What's the next day going to bring? I don't know. And actually, if we allow ourselves, you can get really, really anxious about that. Like, what's going on? And God says, don't worry about it. Why? Because living for today, living one day at a time, is all that you can do. It's actually truly all that we can do. The 2 days of the week that we should never worry about are yesterday and tomorrow. Don't borrow trouble that you don't need, right? Today is the tomorrow that you worried about yesterday. When you worry about tomorrow's problems, one of the big impacts is actually you miss the blessings of today. And there's blessings to be had every day. When you worry about your health, when you worry about your retirement, when you worry about your job, when you worry about whatever, all the stuff that's swirling right now, you miss the blessings of today. Trust God to give you what you actually will need tomorrow. Do we trust God? God, I don't know what tomorrow will bring, but I trust you. You know what's coming. God, you're already there, and you are going to give me exactly what I need. This is why Jesus says to us, he says, you're not to pray, give us this week our daily bread. Give us today our daily bread. Don't give, we're not called to pray for weekly bread, daily bread. And actually, and part of that, actually in that is also, it's telling us, we're actually to come to the Lord daily in prayer. That's why it's even like that. You're not meant to actually go days without prayer. You're actually meant every single day, go to the Lord in prayer. Now, in all this, I'm not saying that we don't plan. Obviously, that we do need to plan, but we don't need to worry. And many times, the planning and the worry seem to be somehow intertwined in our lives. And we get those two all mixed up. And Proverbs says we are to plan, but that we're not meant to worry. We were never created to worry, as we talked about last week. But we plan for death. Why? So that we can live for today. So that we live right now in today. That's why we plan. So that we can enjoy what the Lord has for us today. Now, I want to touch on something too important in all of this for people. If you struggle with chronic anxiety, then by all means, I would say you may actually need to seek professional help, and that can actually be a good thing. Perhaps it's a clinical issue of a chemical imbalance. Seek out a Christian counselor. Seek out a support group that can help you. Those are good things. Those are means that actually God works through to really bring healing and wholeness in our lives. But do that, all those things, do that so that you can actually get your mind stabilized so that you can learn to trust Jesus step by step in your life and grow to learn to trust the Lord more and more and more. Let's not look to anything else in our lives as a substitute for trusting Jesus. Let's not be running to and fro in these days looking for a substitute. We need the Lord. You know, and as I was thinking about this week, I thought, you know, it's probable that this next week will again bring more bad news in our country. That's where we're at. This next week is probably going to be a hard week. And there is going to be an inclination in us to become fearful or to become more fearful. And we are. We are in very serious days. That we are. And this is not a time to plaster a bunch of spiritual talk over the reality and not be real about the reality that we're facing. I actually want to be really real about the reality that we're facing. And God is real about it and God is in it. But I'm not going to plaster a bunch of holy roller spiritual talk over this. No. But we also, it's not the time to allow what's happening in the natural to get our eyes off of what God wants to do in us and what he's doing in all of eternity. We're not meant to be so consumed with what's happening here that we get our eyes off of the Lord. And I believe that we are in the midst of a very serious situation. And I believe from even talking to people that I'm connected with that government leaders and health authorities are feeling just as overwhelmed right now as the rest of us. They are trying to walk through this. But we need our eyes on the Lord. We really, really need our eyes on Jesus, and we need our hearts aligned to Him in these days. You know, and underneath this entire message, and underneath this entire sort of theme, is the understanding that we need to be immersing ourselves and soaking ourselves in the Word of God. That underneath all of this, we are to be in the Word. And if you're not in the Word, if you're not actually using this time to get more and more and more and more into the Word, I would encourage you, begin to do so. Get into the Word. Allow the Lord to speak to you through His Word. And it's amazing how God speaks to us through His Word in days like this. Get your eyes on the King of Glory. So I want to end this morning by inviting us to spend some time in prayer. And this week is going to bring new challenges for us, and we need to give it to the Lord. And so I want to encourage you to take a few minutes here and pray with whoever you're with or on your own between you and the Lord. And let's pray specifically into these things around kind of what we've been learning and looking at in the Word. Pray against worry in your family and in yourself. Pray against it. Pray that the Lord would deliver you from that. Pray that you'd be growing in trusting Jesus, that you'd actually be going deeper and deeper in that. Pray for protection for you and others. Pray that the Lord would be your shield. Pray for a deepening of your hunger for God in these days, that He'd be deepening that in you. And pray for an increase of His presence in your midst, that God would actually be moving in power and coming, and that we'd have a hunger for that and a desire for that like never before. So I'm going to leave you to do that. Let's spend a few minutes here in prayer as we're together, and then we're going to come and we're going to end with some worship. All right, let's just spend some time quieting our hearts and praying together. All right, we're going to end this morning by with some worship together, and so I want to invite Jen and the team up, and I want to invite you, again, wherever you are, just as a way of engaging, I want to invite you to stand. Kids, I hope that you're with us, and we're glad that those of you that are watching and listening to us, we're really glad that you're with us as well, and so let's engage with the Lord together and enjoy the presence of God in worship. You know, at the end of Psalm 16, it says, in your presence there is fullness of joy. And so as we engage and as we welcome the presence of God amongst us, He actually brings just the fullness of His joy in our midst. So Let's do that together.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Let's worship and lifting our eyes and keeping our eyes on Jesus.
Me home here in the power of Christ.
You're good, and that you're working, and that you hold us in your hands, Lord, each and every one of us. Lord, we're secure in you, we're covered by you. Lord, we We trust you, Jesus, we trust you, and we ask you to help us to trust you more and more and more in these days. I want to read something to you as we end this morning that I read at the end of our prayer time this last week together. And it just so spoke to me this week as I read it, and I want to read it over us. Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul. I pray that over every single one of you, all of us in this church, that it may go well with our soul. We don't know what this week holds. Stay close to Jesus. Reach out if you want to talk, if you want to pray. Reach out to us. Reach out to your home group leaders. Let's stay connected. Let's stay close to one another in these days as well. I want to invite you, join us Tuesday morning, 6:30 a.m., Wednesday night, 9 p.m. We'll send out the links. Join us for prayer. We'd love if you want to come and pray with us, and we'll be able to see each other's faces and connect, and it'll be good. So, bless you. Looking forward already to next Sunday, and we'll be here again. We'll be streaming, and looking forward to having Gene Enns with us. He'll be bringing the word. So, really looking forward to what the Lord is speaking to him. So, have a great week, church, and let's stay in touch. Bless you.